Good afternoon. We know that every effort to improve society, especially when injustice and sin are so ingrained, is an effort that God blesses, is an effort that God wants of us. It's an effort that God demands of us. These are the words of Blessed Óscar Romero. The Romero event, the ceremony and the symposium, is one of the signature events of the Human Rights Center, predates the Human Rights Center. It was founded in the year 2000. It's a signature event because it signifies the university's commitment to peace, social justice, and the common good. And it signifies the Human Rights Center, newly created Human Rights Center's commitment to advocate on behalf of the poor and the persecuted. Romero is really what we do at this university. It's been our customary practice since we created this award to invite the Director of Campus Ministry, Crystal Sullivan, to come and deliver our benediction.
Let us pray. God of justice and mercy, you bless us with great witnesses who work passionately for justice and the common good, and inspire us to live the gospel faithfully and courageously. We praise and bless you for our brother in action, Blessed Óscar Romero, your servant whose unfailing voice for justice cost his life, and whose death has outraged and empowered many to speak and to act on behalf of the needs of the poor, and for justice and truth which serve the common good. We praise and bless you for our sister in action, Sister Dorothy Stang, your servant whose courage and action on behalf of farm workers and whose passionate care for the earth cost her life, but gave us another model of solidarity and tireless commitment to human rights work. We gather here to commend the work of more witnesses, the people of the National Conference of Brazilian Bishops Pastoral Land Commission, and the leadership of Bishop Enemésio Lazzaris and Father Xavier Plassat, whose courage and leadership and tireless advocacy has defended the rights of Brazil's landless poor, liberated enslaved workers, and sought to halt the ecological devastation of the Amazon. Generous God, we gather this night and offer a prayer of thanksgiving for these witnesses who have gone before us and who stand among us. We ask you to bless them with safety in acts of defiance and courage, tenacity when they could easily lose hope, and joyful solidarity with all whom they serve and represent. Set your spirit upon Bishop Lazzaris as he speaks to us tonight. May his words instruct, challenge, and inspire us to action. Set your spirit upon us as we receive his words. Inspire us to deeply commit to the practice of human rights and to honor the dignity of all people by taking action to live with solidarity and to change structures and practices that devastate the earth and its people. We pray this in the name of Jesus, whose Paschal mystery gives us hope. Amen.
It's also customary to invite a member of the faculty to deliver remarks, reflections on the ministry and martyrdom of Romero. We have been saying reflections on the ministry and martyrdom of Romero since 2000, and so I was very pleased that the Holy Father declared Romero a martyr in 2015. It made me feel I was orthodox in keeping with the church. We all knew. I'm of that generation who is in human rights today because we were someplace which we all remember when we received word of the assassination of Romero. For me personally, it was simply a question of who would kill an archbishop and why. And for me personally, the years since 1980 have been trying to understand violence and trying to work for human rights, and I was fortunate enough to come to this university in 1989 and given the opportunity to help create the Human Rights Program and this award and the Human Rights Center. And so for all of us in this generation of human rights defenders, it's Romero. It's Dr. King, it's Gandhi, and it's so many others. It's Sister Dorothy. But Romero was that one catalytic event. And so it has been customary, in addition to receiving the acceptance speech from the recipient, in this case the CPT, to invite a member of the faculty to come and present reflections on the ministry and martyrdom of Romero. And so I would like to invite my friend Kelly Johnson, who came to Brazil with us in 2013 and got to meet Brother Xavier and the people working on the ground. I'd like to invite Kelly Johnson, Associate Professor of Religious Studies, to deliver these remarks. Kelly.
I'm honored to give these reflections, especially on the occasion of this recognition of the Pastoral Land Commission, the CPT. As Mark said, in 2013, I was part of a group of scholars from the United States who were invited by Catholic Relief Services to go to Brazil to learn there about work to end contemporary slavery. And under the guidance of Brother Xavier Plassat, some of us spent a couple of days with CPT activists in the state of Piauí, which is in the Northeast. Over lunch on the first day, the local CPT leader, Lucia, introduced us to their work. She told us about the struggle to raise consciousness among landless workers about their rights, to educate them about the lies that could be used to trap them into slavery, and to support people who had been enslaved as they struggled for recognition and compensation. So one of us asked if they got much support from the church locally. And Lucia answered, not that much. Well, why not? She hesitated, and then she said, they don't like conflict. They don't like conflict. I don't like conflict. Getting into a fight means I might lose. I might be exposed as ignorant or a hypocrite. I might win, and then I would have to take responsibility for the positions that I advocated. And arguing takes so much time. It goes on and on. For those of us who have the option to avoid conflict, there are always reasons just to keep our heads down. I think Christian communities are particularly prone to avoiding conflict. People often come to the faith looking for a sense of that beauty that will save the world, for something eternal that will counter the restlessness of consumer culture, for some kind of stillness in the frenzy of digital life. People like me, don't like to have conflict interrupt and complicate that. It's amazing, actually, how often Christians who gaze every day on the image of the crucified manage to sidestep the centrality of conflict in the life of Christ, as though the Prince of Peace were not the same man whose parables antagonized powerful leaders, whose actions provoked controversies that authorities tried to resolve by having him executed. Then on the other hand, some people, and even people like me who usually avoid conflict, love conflict. We get addicted to it. Chris Hedges, in a book called War is a Force That Gives Us Meaning, captured the dynamic. We find a kind of life in the fight because it gives us purpose. Our life is no longer just one day after another. It becomes a blaze of glory, an adrenaline rush, a righteous struggle against a clear evil. And so we sacrifice ourselves for a noble cause, and losing ourselves, we feel at last that life is about something bigger than just paying the bills. So peace, by contrast, comes to seem banal. Thomas à Becket's last temptation in Murder in the Cathedral was to seek out martyrdom, to do the right deed for the wrong reason. Well, Blessed Óscar Romero knew about conflict. He knew a lot about conflict. I think he should be the patron saint for those who are engaged in conflict. After a lifetime of struggle with his temper, in the crucible of his years as archbishop, when the long-standing structural violence of El Salvador broke out into open violence against anyone who took the side of the people. He did conflict well. He did it very well. So for the Pastoral Land Commission, for Sister Dorothy Stang, for those in Brazil who struggled to ensure a right to land, to live on, a roof over their heads, and decent work, standing for justice means entering into conflict, getting into the fight, and staying in it. In this time when so much of our public debate in the United States is torn between an urge to promote mutual understanding to move us toward unity, and an urge, on the other hand, to stand without compromise against injustice and falsehood, when our church is torn between an urge to fight for justice and an urge to meet the transcendent in stillness, Blessed Óscar Romero's ministry and martyrdom show us a way forward. So I learned some things from Ana Maria Pineda this weekend about Óscar Romero. One of them is that Romero, though by temperament he was a bit shy and introverted, he had a hot temper. He apparently prayed throughout his life for his temper to be brought under control. And this wasn't just an issue in his private relationships. Before he was made archbishop, he was serving as editor on the diocesan paper, and he led a polemical charge against some Jesuit educators who he claimed were promoting not Christian teaching, but under the guise of Christianity, a temporal political agenda that was shaped by Marxism. There was an investigation into the charges. They were proved to be false, and so the bishop demanded that Romero publish the findings of that investigation in the paper. So Romero published it on the last page, and also added another article indicating that the members of the committee who did the investigation were not Orthodox Catholics. He was a scrappy fighter who defended the transcendent message of Christianity. He never stopped struggling with his temper, and he never stopped preaching about the supernatural identity of the church, the transcendent nature of faith. Even in his last years, he regularly reminded his flock of the need for prayer and sacraments, for a faith that reaches beyond politics. But as is commonly noted, he did come to a new understanding about the faith, so that as archbishop, his preaching became resolutely committed to the need to address, as he said, not the soul at the hour of death, but the person living in history. This is a bit from a homily of his. God in Christ dwells near at hand to us. Christ has given us a guideline. I was hungry, and you gave me to eat. Where someone is hungry, there is Christ near at hand. If we could see Christ is the needy one, the torture victim, the prisoner, the murder victim, and in each human figure so shamefully thrown by our roadsides, if we could see Christ himself cast aside, we would pick him up like a medal of gold to be kissed lovingly. How far people are today, especially those who torture and kill and value their investments more than human beings, from realizing all the earth's wealth is good for nothing compared to a human being. That person is Christ. And in the person viewed and treated with faith, we look on Christ the Lord. To try to reveal Christ is our great pastoral task. If I speak of earthly matters or political questions, it is to guide our reflection towards Christ. So Romero didn't leave the transcendent behind when he became a prophetic defender of the lives of his people. You know, for Christians, the supernatural is not some other place in time. It's not an escape into fantasy. It's a way of seeing the reality that's around us. It's not about theory. It's about reality. Now, I know that may sound surprising. It's common for people to assume that a theological predisposition towards the transcendent leads somebody to stay out of political controversy, or at least away from challenging the status quo. I think the logic runs something like this. The transcendent equals the spiritual, which equals the immaterial, which must be interior and private, and that's best served by a passive political position, which strongly implies an alliance with the privileged. So a cleric concerned to protect the church's transcendent calling to this way of thinking would naturally be uninvolved in social conflict, and at least tacitly a friend to those currently in power. Preaching about the transcendent will be vague, general, theoretical, or else just focused on private devotion. But Óscar Romero understood that if Christianity means anything, it means that God has become incarnate in human history, and that Christians encounter the transcendent, the source and end of all, their Lord, in Galilee, in El Paznal, in Anapu, in Teresina, in Dayton. He said, "It's very easy to be servants of the word without disturbing the world, a spiritualized word, a word without any commitment to history. What starts conflicts and persecutions, what marks the genuine church, is the word that, burning like the word of the prophets, proclaims and accuses. Proclaims to the people of God wonders to be believed and venerated, accuses of sin those who oppose God's reign, so that they may tear that sin out of their hearts, out of their societies, out of their laws, out of their structures that oppress, that imprison, that violate the rights of God and of humanity." The word that marks the genuine church, he says, is first the proclamation of wonder, that creation, in spite of all that might seem, is made for peace, that humans discarded like garbage are Christ himself, that God is with us, that the kingdom of God is at hand. And beside that proclamation of wonder and accusation of sin, quote, "A preaching that does not point out sin is not the preaching of the gospel. A preaching that makes sinners feel good so that they become entrenched in their sinful state betrays the gospel's call. Naturally, such preaching must meet conflict, must spoil what is miscalled prestige, must disturb, must be persecuted. It cannot get along with the powers of darkness and sin." A commitment to be faithful to the spiritual truth of Christianity demanded that Romero confront falsehood, sin, callous complacency, and that he confront it in unmistakable terms for the sake of bringing about conversion. One of the notes of Romero's spiritual practice of conflict, the bishop told me yesterday that he thought we needed a spirituality of conflict, so here's an idea for it, is attentive listening. He called it a conscience docile to the word of truth that demands conversion. Now, the Benedictine tradition calls that obedience. It's a hard virtue to cultivate, listening in a way that allows yourself to be changed. Romero asked it of the people who heard his homilies, and he practiced it continually himself. He often pointed out that he was only preaching the word that had been entrusted to him. He learned that word from the teaching of the church that he learned from the popes, but he learned it also from his clergy and from the crucified people of El Salvador. He met at length and repeatedly with the clergy and the people of his diocese to listen and to test his understanding against their faithful witness. The transcendent word of God has taken up residence among the faithful, and that is to be attended to. This is the supernatural identity of the church. Romero listened to that, and he allowed himself to be changed, and it did change him. In the summer of 1977, only a few months into his ministry as archbishop, Romero wrote a confidential letter to the prefect of the Congregation of Bishops in Rome in which he discussed a particularly painful conflict for him, that between himself and the papal nuncio, who had been his close ally in the past, but who had become a bitter opponent. In spite of Romero's strong support among clergy and laity, he had met in the Vatican's representative constant opposition to his efforts to speak truthfully about the abuses committed by the powerful. And he wrote in this letter, "On analyzing this strange attitude of his, I have concluded that he lives at a great distance from the problems of our clergy and of humble people, and that with him what has the most weight are the reports of the politicians, the diplomats, the moneyed class of the elegant neighborhoods." Blessed Óscar Romero entered into conflict, when he did it well, not as an act of self-expression, but as a duty arising from his listening to the people of God, in whose lives he met again and again Christ himself. So this means that at the heart of his entering into conflict was his willingness to enter into encounter. You know, we can use conflict as a way to avoid meeting someone else, to create distance. That's part of the appeal of conflict, as Chris Hedges describes it, the clear boundaries it creates, right, between friend and foe. Romero's confrontational preaching grew from, and he always hoped led into, greater encounter, including with the people he most criticized. He said, "It gives me pleasure that my enemies listen to me. I know the reason they listen to me is that I bear them a message of love. I don't hate them. I don't want revenge. I wish them no harm. I beg them to be converted, to come to be happy with the happiness that you, my congregation, have." That call, spoken in love, maybe especially because it is spoken in love, could only be met either by repentance or by greater opposition. Sor Romero says, "There is conflict. God be blessed. When a sore spot is touched, there is conflict, there is pain. No one wants to have a sore spot touched, and therefore a society with so many sores twitches when someone has the courage to touch it and to say, you have to treat that. You have to get rid of that." Romero counted conflict as a blessing for the sake of truthful encounter in the hope that healing could come. He was touching the wounds of his community. When one touches the wounds of humanity, the beloved of Christ, and all the more so when one touches the wounds of the church, which is the body of Christ, there one encounters God. You know, the Gospel of John tells us that Jesus commanded Thomas to touch the nail prints in his hands, right? To put his hand in his side. This is no vague reference to theoretical, abstract suffering. Put your hand in my side. And that's the path that leads to Thomas's great cry of faith, "My Lord and my God," touching the wounds. The grace of God is not above the fray. So how does grace enter into the fray when truth is denied, when justice is flaunted? The answer is the cross, as Blessed Óscar Romero's ministry and martyrdom display. He said, "The shepherd does not want security while they give no security to the flock." Romero wasn't trying in conflict to establish his superiority or to destroy his opponents. He wasn't trying to win. Having listened, having been changed, he spoke to those he continued to identify as his family, a troubled, an even murderous family, to struggle together towards reunion. And he spoke to them directly and concretely. It was risky. He was getting into the struggle without the shield of anonymity or vagueness. He wasn't lobbing a grenade from behind a wall or ordering a drone strike from 20,000 feet. This is hand to hand, right? This is encounter. And you can get hurt. Romero was criticized, he was labeled as subversive, he was undermined, insulted, and finally he was killed. Entering into conflict and staying there was a long path of dying to self that for Romero was finally fulfilled in his martyrdom. But I think the most important element of Romero's blessed conflict is that death isn't the last word. The gospel that made Romero see with such clarity the abomination of systemic injustice also allowed him to see hope. Everything is not fine. Clearly, everything is not fine. We've seen the bodies. We've heard the blatant falsehoods and the subtle rationalizations repeated so often that they become platitudes. We know about land grabs, about the destruction of the Amazon, the displacement of people, the enslavement of workers. And it's easy to despair. I mean, it's easy to despair. Easier than conflict, anyway. But we've had enough of that. Romero preached the great need today is for Christians who are active and critical, who don't accept situations without analyzing them inwardly and deeply. We want persons like fruitful fig trees who can say yes to justice and no to injustice and can make use of the precious gift of life, regardless of the circumstances. That kind of vitality requires hope. You know, we call hope a supernatural virtue because it's a propensity to act toward an end that is beyond nature, beyond death, toward the heavenly banquet at which we all may feast with the triune God who gives and receives love as the very source of our reality. To engage in the conflict that follows when we touch the wounds of our society without seeking safety that's denied to others. It's only possible to do this when there is hope that the good news is actually good news. that our struggle leads to something more than a tactical victory. The peace we long for is not a fantasy. It is, in fact, what lies at the heart of reality. God is not overcome by sin. Nor is Oscar Romero, nor is Dorothy Stang, nor the thousands of martyrs who stand with them. But the sign of that peace in our world, so broken by sin, is the sign of the cross. One of the hard things about conflict is that we can't know, any more than Romero knew, that we're right, that we'll be safe, that history will remember us favorably. But you know, and I pay attention to coincidences like this. Last weekend at a conference, I met a religious sister from Vietnam who told me that they had a saying, "We walk in darkness, but as we walk, we sing." And yesterday, Bishop Lazzaris repeated the same thought to me. It's a cry they use at CPT. "It is dark, but I sing." I tell you, grace is a weed. It springs up everywhere, the most unlikely places. The promise of incarnate grace is that the same God who is beyond our imagination, beyond our aspirations, beyond our best efforts and our attempts to stake out once and for all the right position so that we can hold it against all comers, that God has taken up residence among humanity, not as a horizon of aspiration, not as otherworldly consolation, but in the beloved brother and sister with whom we argue, even in the one who kills. Romero says, "He is not a distant God. Transcendent, yes, infinite, but a God close at hand here on earth." A few years ago, I spoke with a bishop in Northern Ireland who told me that his congregations had found they had to choose between being sites of consolation or sites of justice. I understand this, I expect you do as well. If the congregation began to speak truthfully to each other about their situation, they would no longer feel safe, comfortable with each other. The flow of comfort would be interrupted, and for people living in a society so plagued with a history of hatred and division, the need for a place of recollection, of calm, it's not a trivial need. Romero himself said, "Blessed are those who enter often to speak alone with their God." He knew that we need to cultivate that. But Romero challenges us also to recognize that the gospel offers no consolation that exists outside of truth-telling and struggle, of dying to ourselves. Because he also said, "Blessed are those who feel and live the crisis and settle it with a commitment to the Lord." That's not a contradiction. There is a kind of consolation that comes with struggle in the midst of dying to ourselves by engaging in conflict that's driven by our love of others. There we find, in fact, a new intimacy with Christ. Romero, and how characteristic this is of the saints, was not a dour or gloomy man. He delighted in his work, in his people, in his faith. "Those who lose their lives for my sake and for the gospel will find them." You know, these confrontational words I've read to you from Romero's homilies, they were spoken during Mass, amid songs and silent prayer and Eucharistic thanksgiving. How small, how parochial we've let our imaginations become. To avoid offending each other, we avoid speaking the truth, and then we wonder why the faith among us seems to be dead. The consolation of the gospel is not like an hour of TV after a work day. It's not like a weekend at the beach, a little reprieve from reality. It is new creation. What was broken beyond repair is redeemed. What was lost is found. The world has turned. We come to church looking for a consolation too trivial, and we resist those voices like Romero's, like Pope Francis's, who invite us to encounter in the wounds of the world, the wounds of others and of ourselves, the presence of our joy. Christ promises us peace, but it's a peace that surpasses all understanding. Romero preached this hope that counters despair and bitterness, even as it stands with its eyes open with a bruised body in the heart of a sin-sick world. He said, "Let us sing a song of hope and be filled with cheerful spirit, knowing that this Christian life, which came to us with Christ through the Virgin Mary and takes on flesh in all believers, is the presence of God, who makes us a promise. Brothers and sisters, we need not always live like this. God's banquet will come. Wait for the Lord's hour. Let us have faith. All this will pass away like a national nightmare, and we shall awake to the Lord's great feast. Let us be filled with this hope." Blessed Óscar Romero, pray for us.
Cries, the cries of the suffering that must be heard. No one knew the suffering or heard the cries firsthand more than Blessed Óscar Romero. A fearless and outspoken advocate for the rights of all humans, Romero spoke for all those suffering people whose cries rose up to heaven. Making many enemies, Romero pleaded with Salvadoran soldiers.
En nombre de Dios, pues, y en nombre de este sufrido pueblo, cuyos lamentos suben hasta el cielo cada día más tumultuosos, les suplico, les ruego, les ordeno, en nombre de Dios,
the very next day, while delivering mass at a hospital, Romero was fatally shot. In 2015, Pope Francis declared Archbishop Óscar Romero a martyr for his work in human rights. He was beatified in May 2015. Pope Francis called Romero a voice that continues to resonate. Inspired by Romero's work, the University of Dayton Human Rights Center stands today as a beacon to the university's dedication to promoting the inherent dignity of all persons through research, education, and in dialogue with the Catholic Church's social justice tradition, to search for transformative solutions to systematic injustice. The Blessed Óscar Romero Award is bestowed upon individuals and organizations whose work has contributed significantly to the promotion of the dignity of all persons and the alleviation of the suffering of the human community. The recipient of the 2017 Romero Award is Comissão Pastoral de Terra, the Pastoral Land Commission. Hearing the cry coming from the Brazilian fields and forests, the Brazilian National Bishops' Conference formed CPT to defend the rights of Brazil's landless poor, liberate enslaved workers, and halt the devastation of the Amazon. With development and greed driving indiscriminate deforestation, CPT advocates respectful coexistence with diverse ecosystems. CPT fights for workers locally and advocates for them at a national and international level. They provide education and training that has saved countless desperately poor and vulnerable Brazilians from falling victim to enslavement. CPT monitors and reports conflict and violence in the field to shine a light on the struggles of the people. In the past 20 years, the Commission has helped Brazilian authorities in the liberation of more than 50,000 enslaved workers and helped victims obtain back wages and find decent work. In 2005, Dayton native Sister Dorothy Stang was murdered while working with CPT in the fight for human rights, sustainable development, and land reform in the Brazilian Amazon. Led by CPT President Bishop Enemésio Lazzaris, the organization continues to advocate for the traditional communities who struggle to maintain their dignity as farmers. Today, we honor the Pastoral Land Commission for hearing their cry, promoting human dignity, and alleviating the suffering of the human family.
This is the part I like most about this event. It's my honor to invite President Spina and Bishop Enemésio Lazzaris for the presentation of the Romero Award.
I'm deeply honored today to present on behalf of the University of Dayton the Blessed Óscar Romero Human Rights Award to the National Conference of Brazilian Bishops Pastoral Land Commission. This international award honors the ministry and martyrdom of Blessed Romero, one of the most vocal defenders of the human rights of the poor and disenfranchised. We are inspired by your courageous work in Brazil on behalf of the poor, the landless, and victims of slave labor. Despite the danger, the Pastoral Land Commission has worked selflessly for decades in solidarity with the poor and the persecuted. Thank you, Bishop Enemésio Lazzaris and Brother Xavier Plassat, for traveling to the University of Dayton to accept this award. More importantly, thank you for your courage, your faith, and your advocacy for the dignity of all people, especially the least among us. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Xavier, dá uma mãozinha ali para a questão da tradução, né? Vai passar lá, né?
É.
Em nome da CPT, Comissão Pastoral da Terra, saúdo carinhosamente cada um dos senhores, cada uma das senhoras que está aqui presente, especialmente os organizadores e promotores deste evento, de modo particular, o Dr. Eric Spina, presidente desta Universidade de Dayton. Quero, antes de mais nada, prestar uma homenagem a São Romero da América, mártir salvadorenho, assassinado em 1980, a filha desta terra, irmã Dorothy Stang, que tombou em defesa dos povos da floresta amazônica em 2005, e aos 1.833 homens e mulheres assassinados no campo brasileiro desde 1985. 1.833. A Comissão Pastoral da Terra completou em 2015 40 anos de existência. Ela foi criada em 75 durante um encontro de bispos, padres e agentes de pastoral da Amazônia em tempos de ditadura militar, como resposta à grave situação vivida pelos trabalhadores rurais e poceiros, expulsos de suas terras e peões submetidos à condição análoga à de trabalho escravo. Nasceu vinculada à Igreja Católica, mas logo adquiriu caráter ecumênico com a participação de outras igrejas, como é o caso da Igreja Evangélica de Confissão Luterana no Brasil, a Igreja Metodista. O vínculo com estas igrejas deu cobertura, deu força aos trabalhos que foram sendo realizados em períodos de forte repressão. Ao longo dos 40 anos, a entidade apoiou, acompanhou e assessorou os povos da terra, das águas e das florestas. Estimulou mulheres e homens do campo a se organizarem em associações e movimentos, como o MST, Movimento Sem Terra, o MAB, Movimento dos Atingidos por Barragens, o MMC, Movimento das Mulheres do Campo, a lutarem por direitos e contra a violência. Presente em todo o país, a CPT está organizada em 21 regionais, em 120 equipes de base, contando com 725 agentes de pastoral e 525 voluntários, voluntárias. Sensíveis aos clamores dos povos da terra, das águas e das florestas, homens e mulheres, como Pedro Casaldáliga, Tomás Balduino, ambos bispos, Chico Mendes, irmã Dorothy, padre Josimo Tavares, Dom Luiz Cápio, José Cláudio, Maria do Espírito Santo da Silva, Adelaide, Chicão Chucuru e Gringo, gritaram contra a escravidão dos trabalhadores. Gritaram contra a escravidão dos trabalhadores do campo. Defenderam os povos das florestas. Lutaram em defesa da água e dos direitos dos poceiros. E ainda por uma igreja em permanente luta pelo direito dos mais pobres. Alguns ainda estão entre nós, iluminando nossos caminhos e nossas ações. Outros partiram e alguns tombaram pelas armas impiedosas do poderoso latifúndio. Seu sangue regou o solo, reforçou nossa resistência e semeou e regou muitas sementes. Seu sangue regou o solo, reforçou nossa resistência e semeou e regou muitas sementes de esperança. Desde o início, a CPT registra e denuncia os conflitos e a violência que envolve trabalhadores e trabalhadoras do campo. Hoje, dispõe de um rico acervo de documentos sobre esse assunto. Anualmente, desde 1985, a CPT publica o relatório dos conflitos no campo Brasil. É um registro da história de luta de uma classe que secularmente foi explorada, excluída e violentada. Este relatório se propõe a sensibilizar a sociedade diante do quadro dos conflitos e da violência que atingem homens e mulheres no campo e alimentar e reforçar a luta e a resistência dos próprios trabalhadores. Desde que se começou a publicar esse caderno, em 1985, praticamente 30 anos atrás, foram registrados 1.833 assassinatos. Entre eles estão defensores de direito, camponeses e lideranças em luta pelo território e pela reforma agrária. O ano de 2016 deixou uma marca de retrocesso em nosso país. enquanto os holofotes estavam voltados para o Planalto em Brasília, na planície, isto é, no campo brasileiro, os indígenas, os quilombolas, os poceiros, os pescadores artesanais e tantas outras comunidades tradicionais foram abandonadas à própria sorte, inclusive com a ameaça da desconstrução de direitos adquiridos na Constituição Cidadã de 1988. O latifúndio passou a reagir de maneira mais violenta contra as ocupações e retomadas, inclusive fortalecendo seu combate, utilizando-se de milícias armadas, aliado às bancadas ruralistas, da Bíblia e da bala, boi, Bíblia, bala. O latifúndio se fortaleceu e partiu para cima dos camponeses indígenas com unhas e dentes, fazendo em 2016 61 vítimas. 49 aconteceram na região da Amazônia, em Rondônia. Rondônia disparou no ranking com 21 assassinatos. A impunidade tem sido uma das causas que em nosso país vai gerando uma cadeia de violência. Podemos dizer que, no mínimo, o judiciário brasileiro tem sido omisso. Se limitando apenas a julgar e condenar os criminosos diretamente envolvidos, os assassinos, e deixando passar ilesos ao menos ou mais de 90% dos mandantes. Percebe-se uma clara cumplicidade entre os poderes constituídos, especialmente o judiciário, o latifúndio e o agronegócio. Os pequenos são julgados e condenados, e os grandes continuam a fazer o que bem entendem. Constata-se que a intensificação dos conflitos está situada onde há expansão do agronegócio, da mineração e das grandes obras de infraestrutura. Neste momento, um dos grandes desafios para o campesinato brasileiro é a privatização e a estrangeirização das terras. Além do Mato Piba, que é o programa do governo federal que coloca à disposição do agronegócio nada mais, nada menos do que 75 milhões de hectares, situados sobretudo nas regiões do Cerrado, dos estados do Maranhão, do Tocantins, do Piauí e da Bahia. Esta nova fronteira agrícola se constitui uma grande ameaça, não só para os territórios dos povos originários e para as comunidades tradicionais, mas também a toda a rica e vasta biodiversidade presente nestes quatro estados. Em vista de maior produção de commodities para exportação e para o seu escoamento, estão sendo ampliadas a infraestrutura com mais rodovias, ferrovias, hidrovias. Nesta pauta estão previstos novos portos e aeroportos, sendo que alguns serão ampliados. Tudo isso desestabiliza, tudo isso impacta as comunidades dos territórios e trará consequências funestas a toda a biodiversidade, especialmente para a fauna e para a flora. É mergulhados nesta realidade do anti-reino, que como pastores entre lobos, somos chamados como profetas a cuidar das ovelhas. Como pastores no meio de lobos, somos chamados a cuidar das ovelhas, anunciando-lhes a boa nova do reino, que é de justiça, de amor, de paz, de terra repartida, alimentados pela utopia de um novo céu e uma nova terra, e solidários com homens e mulheres de boa vontade, continuaremos lutando e resistindo para que a terra seja de todos. Continuaremos lutando e resistindo para que a terra seja de todos e para que na casa comum haja espaço de vida plena, não só para o ser humano, mas para todas as criaturas. Em sintonia com o Papa Francisco, não deixaremos que nos roubem a esperança e continuaremos a ser mensageiros do reino de Jesus de Nazaré, anunciando o evangelho da alegria, comprometidos com o cuidado da casa comum, defendendo sempre a integridade da criação, contemplando a beleza e a diversidade dos nossos povos e dos biomas que formam o nosso território brasileiro. A economia global, a agricultura está submetida à lógica dos mercados e das bolsas, e nossa vida cotidiana é cada vez mais mediada por tecnologia. No entanto, a terra permanece como que subjaz a universalidade dos direitos, pois todos nós, seres humanos, chamamos-nos e somos assim, porque nascemos do mesmo húmus, da mesma terra. A irmã Dorothy é testemunha ímpar a nos lembrar sempre que a terra é mais que a terra, que não é uma mercadoria e muito menos uma variável financeira, como urubus da grilagem de terra costumam considerar, mas um valor sagrado a ser protegido, uma exigência para a afirmação da dignidade humana, matéria-prima e fonte viva da cultura e identidade dos povos. Irmã Dorothy e Óscar Romero, ambos canonizados no coração de nossos povos. Irmã Dorothy e Óscar Romero, ambos santos canonizados no coração de nossos povos, deixaram preciosa mensagem para aqueles que ainda repetem o refrão de que a Igreja deve abster-se da política para se dedicar às coisas do céu, deve permanecer na sacristia, pregando um espiritualismo anestesiante que nada tem a ver com Jesus Cristo e com o Evangelho libertador. O verdadeiro cristão, ao contrário, é aquele que se compromete com toda a força para tornar o mundo, ou melhor, a terra mais habitável, hoje e sempre, defendendo os direitos, especialmente os direitos dos pobres e dos marginalizados. Todos os direitos para todos, todos os direitos para todos. Sigamos os ideais que inspiraram nossos proféticos defensores do direito dos povos, no caminho de Bartolomeu de las Casas, Francisco de Vitória, Martin Luther King, Óscar Romero, Dorothy. Honrada, honrada e profundamente agradecida por este prêmio, Óscar Romero, a CPT continuará cuidando da casa comum e dos nossos irmãos e irmãs mais necessitados e marginalizados, quer nativos ou migrantes, comprometida com o testemunho evangélico do anjo da Amazônia, irmã Dorothy, e do pastor fiel, Monsenhor Romero. Enquanto lutarmos pela justiça e pelo direito, eles permanecerão vivos, caminhando ao nosso lado para sempre. Dorothy, presente.
Dorothy.
Presente. Óscar Romero, presente. Dorothy, presente. Romero,
presente.
Thank you. Obrigado.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you all for joining us. For me, it's a very special honor as the new director of the Human Rights Center to have the opportunity to participate in this award ceremony for the first time. I wanted to just make a few comments in closing before I invite you to join us in a reception. We're here to thank Bishop Lazzaris and Fray Xavier and the CPT for their inspiration. That's really the point of departure. We're here to honor the spirit of faith, solidarity, and resistance, which is embodied by the examples of Monsignor Romero, of Sister Dorothy Stang, and of the CPT. But we have to begin by thanking those who have made this moment possible. We want to thank Mark, first of all, for his vision that has brought us here tonight. We want to thank President Spina, Provost Benson, Rector Fitz, Deans Pierce and Strauss for their presence, their leadership, and the support that makes our work possible at the Human Rights Center. And all of the colleagues who contribute to our work, our staff at the Human Rights Center, our colleagues who participate with their efforts as associates and who have lent their voice and their reflections to our program tonight. We want to thank especially the students who make our work possible and the staff who make our work possible. We want to thank Monty and Youssef and Alexander and Adi, Gaba, Camila, all of you, for your efforts in making this moment possible as well, and the members of our advisory council who are present, Peter and Mark. The work of Monsignor Romero, of Sister Dorothy Stang, and of the CPT is the work of the Human Rights Center. The Romero Award highlights the kind of issues that are at the center of our vision. Whether it is our work regarding forced labor in Brazil that you've heard about today and its regional implications, which will unfold in the next few months in collaboration with a participant in our panel this afternoon who wasn't able to join us from the Pan-Amazonial Ecclesial Network, REPAM, as we explore the regional implications of this research as to forced labor in Brazil, or locally here, in collaboration with Abolition Ohio, with Welcome Dayton, with the Social Action Office of the Archdiocese, or in defense of migrant rights at the U.S.-Mexico border in partnership with Hope Border Institute, or in the streets of Ferguson through the Moral Courage Project, or in Malawi through the research colloquium there, in Colombia, as we speak, in defense of the peace process, and there and in Mexico, as we stand with human rights defenders who've been under attack, the inspiration and the guiding threads are the same. Please join with us at the Human Rights Center as we deepen and further articulate these efforts, strengthened by the inspiration we have witnessed tonight. Thank you.